Blessings, everyone. Blessings, blessings. Amen. Glory to God. Praise the Lord, everyone. We're about to begin our live stream Bible study. Great Emmanuel Apostolic Church in Chattanooga, Tennessee. Praise the Lord. Going to give a minute or so for everybody to come on in and join us for tonight's Bible study. God bless you. God bless you, everyone. Hallelujah, Jesus. What a mighty God we serve. What a holy God we serve. What a righteous God we serve. Hallelujah. Full of grace and truth. That's what the Bible declares. We're just giving a few seconds. Excuse me, just giving a little bit of time. Amen. Praise the Lord. We've got Sister Carmen, Sister Vonda, Sister Robin. Praise the Lord. Amen. For those that are joining us. Amen. Glory to God. So good to see you all joining in with us. Good to be back in Bible study. I was away Wednesday, couldn't make it. Sunday was away. Amen. Praise the Lord. Sister Maria Johnson, Sister Doris, Sister Rochelle, Brother Key. Amen. Praise the Lord. Well, we're going to go ahead and we're going to pray. We want the Lord to have his way today. And I know we have just a few with us right now. We know others will be joining us. Amen. Want to pray. And as we pray, I want to say this. It's no secret as to what's going on in our society. But our society is exactly where the Bible told us that it would be. When you, of course, you deal with, we've been dealing with for several months now, the COVID-19 virus and that situation. And now the newer ordeal that we're dealing with the social injustice that has been done in our nation, and it's one of many. So what do we do? Well, we must pray. We must remember that God is in charge. That's what I believe we ought to do. I believe that when I am praying, I'm asking the Lord to guide me and not to be afraid. I don't think it's the time for us to fear. And I know that many people, if they're not careful, if we don't have the Lord on our side, we can fear. But I'm telling you, let us pray. Let us pray for the family of George Floyd. Let us pray for all of many situations that have been done, whether they've hit the media or not, that we may or may not know about. Let us pray and just ask the Lord to have his way in the name of Jesus. Come on, let's pray right now. Father, we give you glory right now. And we honor you and we praise you and we thank you for all that you are doing. And Father, for all that you have done in our lives. And we're asking you, we know right now that this is a tumultuous time, and you told us that in the last days that perilous times would come. That means that dangerous times are, we are now even living in those times. But we believe by the power of God that you are more mighty, that you are mightier than any situation that we're dealing with, God. And you have promised to us that you would keep us, Father, even in the hour of temptation, which seems to be upon us even right now, God. Even in the last days which we are living in, even John declared that in the last days that there would be antichrist, and even now are there antichrists in the world. But God, we're asking you to continue to lead us and guide us. Let us be the children of God that you desire for us to be. Father, let us handle things the way that you would handle them, the way that you want us to handle them, and not let flesh get involved and not let flesh get in the way, God. There's so many situations, atrocities, and things that have happened in this country that could make us angry, Lord God. But we understand, Lord, we're asking you right now, don't let it divide the body of Christ, Father. Father, let us stay together, Lord, for you said that there was one Lord, one faith, and one baptism. You told us that nation would rise up against nation, God. Kingdom would rise up against kingdom, and people would rise up against one another, Father. But we're asking you in this hour for your hand of protection, God. We're asking you, Lord God, to fulfill your word, which we know that you will, because you must. Because there are two immutable things in the which that you cannot lie. And that is your counsel and your oath, God. We give you today, Father, glory and honor and praise. Lift up your name. We thank you and praise you and glorify you. In Jesus' name, amen, amen. We continue to pray for each and every one of you. And we just love each and every one of you. Well, praise God. We're going to get right into the Bible study. So good to see all of those that are on here. Amen. And we're in Joshua chapter number 8. Lord, ask you to have your way. Let the people hear you and not me, in Jesus' name. Joshua chapter number 8 and verse number 1. The theme here in chapter 8 of Joshua is the destruction at Ai. And I didn't get a chance. I apologize to send your notes out. I'll get these notes plus next week's notes to you sometime this week. But I've got it titled here, The Rematch. Amen. As you know, in Joshua chapter number 7, how when they went to Ai and they were not victorious, because the Bible says in Joshua 7 and 1 that the children of Israel committed a trespass in the accursed sin. And so they were beaten. They were beaten silly, one could say. They were beaten. And so they lost that fight. But they were commanded to do something. Joshua had a command from God of what to do. And that was to get rid of, to stone Achan and his family. And they did that. And now the Bible picks it up in Joshua chapter number 8 and says, "And the Lord said unto Joshua, Fear not, neither be thou dismayed. Take all the people of war with thee, and arise, go up to Ai. See, I have given into thy hand the king of Ai, and his people, and his city, and his land." After Joshua did exactly what he was supposed to do, what God had commanded him to do, when you begin here in chapter 8, the first thing that God says after Joshua obeyed his command, the Bible says in Isaiah 1 and 18, it says, "Come now, let us reason together. Saith the Lord, though your sins be as scarlet, they shall be as white as snow. Though they be red like crimson, they shall be as wool." Verse 19 says, "If ye be willing and obedient, ye shall eat of the good of the land. But if you refuse and rebel, you will be devoured by the sword, for the Lord, for the mouth of the Lord has spoken it." So what he is saying here is that you've been obedient now. And that's for us to understand. Again, that's Isaiah 1 and 18 and 19. He says, "Come now, let us reason together." He goes on to say, "If you be willing and obedient, you will eat of the good of the land." That goes to Joshua 1 and 8, where he says, "Meditate on the word day and night, then shalt thou be prosperous, and then will you have good success." Okay, now he says, "Fear not." Now the first thing that God says to Joshua upon sending him to Ai is, "Fear not." Now that Israel has been purged from sin, from the sin of the accursed thing that was dealt with in chapter 7, victory is certain. Let's take a moment here to talk about being purged from sin. The Bible says, I believe it's in 2 Corinthians 7 and 1, it says, to cleanse ourselves, that we are to cleanse ourselves from all filthiness of the flesh and of the spirit. We must purge ourselves. We have to be purged according to what the Word of God says. Then again, he talks about purify your hearts and purify your hands. That's what the Bible talks about in James chapter 4. So we must be purged from sin. That's why the Bible is, repentance is extremely important. And when there is a wrong, it is very important for us to make that wrong right. There was a situation I believe it was in dealing with the kings. It may be in Samuel, one of the Samuels somewhere. But there was a situation where there was a famine, there was a drought that was going on in the land. And in the middle in that situation, they prayed about what is going on, what is this drought. And the Lord spoke to the prophet and said, it is because of, I believe it was the Gibeonites. They had done something wrong. They had not followed the vow that they had committed to. And what they did was they went to God to get it right. And that's what the Bible is pointing us to go to God to get our situations right and to purge them out, to clean ourselves out. When you talk about purging, you look at a very good chapter to look at is Psalm 51. When you're dealing with David and this sin, and one of the things that David does is he says, against thee and thee only have I sinned and done this wicked. I've done this evil against thee and thee only. I understand that I killed someone. But what I understand, and I understand that I committed adultery, and it seems like this is against other people. But first of all, I let you down. And so what he's doing is he's saying, purge me, God. Clean me up. And so when we get ready to go to battle and do battle God's way, the Bible is telling us that we must repent, that it's imperative for us to be purged. It's imperative for us to be clean and to purge ourselves. Now, why doesn't Joshua have to fear? Sin is out of the way. When we remove sin, we can see the power of God in our lives. Isaiah, I believe it's Isaiah 59, talks about that the Lord's his ear is not heavy that it cannot hear, and his hand is not shortened that he cannot save. But your iniquities have separated you between you and your God. Your sin, your lawlessness, your failure to be obedient unto me, that is what has separated you between me and you. It separated you from me. So why do I not have to fear? Here's some reasons. First of all, you don't have to fear any longer, Joshua, because sin is out of my life. Can you imagine when you don't have to look over your shoulder, when we don't have to look over our shoulder and wonder, or why did this happen, or why did this happen, or why did that happen? When we get sin out of our lives, when we get attitude out of our lives, when we get things that God does not desire, when we get accursed things out of our lives, things that we value above God. That's essentially what the accursed thing was. It's something that Achan held more valuable. And Achan's sin was selfish. It was selfish because it led to people being killed that were his brethren. And so those are the things that we must think about when we're dealing with sin and when we're dealing with temptation. We know that temptation will come, but we also know that when it does come, that he's going to help us to get through it, and he will make a way of escape. I believe that's according to 1 Corinthians 10 and 13, that he's going to help us through that temptation, that we shall not be overtaken by that temptation. So now, why don't I have to fear? Because there's a promise that I've given you. And sometimes I just need you to go back and remember the promise that I've given to you. The Bible says in Deuteronomy 1 and 21, behold, the Lord thy God hath set the land before thee. Go up and possess it as the Lord God of thy fathers hath said unto thee. Fear not, neither be discouraged. Why don't I have to fear? Deuteronomy 7 and 16, and thou shalt consume all the people which the Lord thy God shall deliver thee. Thine eyes shall have no pity upon them, neither shalt thou serve their God. For that will be a snare unto thee if thou wouldst say in thine heart, these nations are more than I. How can I dispossess them? Then thou shalt not be afraid of them, but shalt well remember what the Lord thy God did unto Pharaoh and unto all Egypt. Deuteronomy 31 and 8 says, and the Lord, he it is that doth go before thee. He will be with thee. He will not fail thee, neither forsake thee, neither fear not, neither be dismayed. Let me use this as an opportunity to talk about some of the things that we've been going through as a nation. I know that it may be in someone's mind, well, now I'm afraid. I don't want to deal with law enforcement. I'm afraid that if I get pulled over, this and that is going to happen. Or I'm afraid it could be in a situation that's in regards to the unjust. It could be in a situation in regards to COVID-19. But what God is saying is that I have given a promise unto you, and the Lord, and he it is that doth go before thee, he will be with thee. He will not fail thee, neither forsake thee. Fear not, neither be dismayed. Don't be confused. Don't be overwhelmed. Don't be overtaken by the things that are going on in the world. Joshua 1:5 says, there shall not any man be able to stand before thee all the days of thy life. Does someone want to take a moment right now and just begin to claim that? What do you mean? Nobody's going to be able to fight you forever. Come on, somebody. Amen. Glory to God. They're not going to be able to stand before you all the days of your life. As I was with Moses, so I will be with thee. I will not fail thee nor forsake thee. Be strong and of a good courage. For unto this people shalt thou divide for an inheritance the land. That's why I can go in confidence, even though I was defeated before at Ai. When I realized the reason I was defeated, and now when I hear God's commission saying, now I want you to go up because you've taken care of the problem. You've taken care of the situation. And now you can go up. And not only are you going to go up, you're going to go up with confidence. The confidence that you're going to go up with is being confident, amen, that he which hath begun a good work in you, Philippians 1:6, amen, shall perform it, amen, until that day of Jesus Christ. He shall perfect that which concerneth me. And that is what I believe in the house today. I must believe what the word of God says. He goes on to say in Joshua 1, only be thou strong and very courageous, that thou mayest observe to do according to all the law which Moses my servant commanded thee. Turn not from it to the right hand or to the left hand, that thou mayest prosper whithersoever thou goest. This book of the law shall not depart out of thy mouth, but thou shalt meditate therein day and night, that thou mayest observe to do according to all that is written. My success in the spirit realm is predicated on my meditating in the word day and night. When I meditate on his word, that's what's going to help me to love when flesh wants to hate. When I meditate on his word, that's what's going to help me to do right when I want to do wrong. To walk away from that young lady, from that young man, whatever that situation is, when I meditate on his word, because I'm getting the word that is hidden in my heart that I won't sin against him, that's letting me know to go this way, to go that way, that's guiding my steps. Order my steps, Lord, according to your word. And lead me, Father, in a plain path. The Bible goes on to say in Joshua 1:9, have not I commanded thee? Be strong and of a good courage. Be not afraid, neither be thou dismayed, for the Lord thy God is with thee, whithersoever thou goest. Why are you spending so much time talking about this? Fear is what is trying to come upon the enemy. Praise the Lord, Pastor Robertson. Amen. Fear is what is trying to come upon the people of God in this hour. And I've been saying it since the beginning of all this, and I said it before then in 2 Timothy 1:7. Amen. That God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. That is what God has given us, and what the Lord is wanting us to do. He's wanting us to walk in his power. What the enemy wants to do is he wants us, listen, fear cripples the child of God, because fear makes us focus on what the enemy is saying and not on what God is saying. And so Joshua is going up, and notice they've already been defeated, right? But now he's going up once again, but now he has the confidence because he knows that sin is behind him. Paul said, forgetting those things that are behind me, I press toward the mark for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. So regardless of the fact that I may have failed before, I know why I failed. I know why the mission was not successful. And now I know that we can move on and go forward in God. And as I go on, see, and you know one of the reasons why he said, fear not? Because he knows that Joshua was human. And what could be going on in Joshua's mind is, well, What if somebody else messed up? What if we did something else wrong? You know, but he letting Joshua know, you're going to be successful. You've purged the sin and you're going to be successful. Now we look here, as we go on, it says, and thou shalt do to Ai and her king, as thou didst unto Jericho and her king. Only the spoil thereof and the cattle thereof shall you take for a prey unto yourselves. Lay thee an ambush for the city behind it. There appear to be different instructions in regards to what to do with the possessions of the land than at the Battle of Jericho. Let's take a look. Joshua 8 and 2, I just read it. Then Joshua 8 and 27 says, only the cattle and the spoil of that city Israel took for a prey unto themselves, according unto the word of the Lord, which he commanded Joshua. What do they do in Joshua chapter number 6, verse 21? And they utterly destroyed all that was in the city, both man and woman, young and old, and ox and sheep and ass with the edge of the sword. In Joshua chapter number 6, he had them to destroy the cattle, the ox, the sheep, the ass. In Joshua chapter number 8, it says in 27, verse 27, only the cattle and the spoil of that city Israel took for a prey unto themselves, according unto the word of the Lord. What are you saying? We have to constantly be listening to the voice of God. Because how I'm dealing with today, or rather how I dealt with yesterday, may not necessarily be the same exact way that I deal with tomorrow. How I dealt with this particular situation is not necessarily how I'm going to deal, or how I dealt with a situation in the past is not necessarily how I'm going to deal with the situation of tomorrow. That's why the Bible tells us in Romans 8 and 26 that, listen, that the Spirit of God maketh intercession for us and groanings which cannot be uttered. What we understand here is that, or rather, if I back it up, it says, we know not how to pray as we ought. We don't know what to say. We don't know how to pray. That's why the disciples said, teach us how to pray. And Christ gave them the model for prayer. But what is that model? Our Father, give us this day our daily bread. There may be some of you that like the same thing, but very few people eat the same exact thing every day. What are you saying by that daily bread? We need a word from God on a daily basis. We need a word for God to guide us through our jobs, to guide us through pandemics. So even if there's a next pandemic, and there will be, amen, that hits the face of the earth, whether it's our lifetime or not, there will be, amen. But it's going to be different how we handle it. That means we must constantly be listening to the voice of God. When we want war, when we want to be victorious in warfare, why are we dealing with all this war? Because the Bible says in 2 Corinthians chapter number 10, for the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but they are mighty through God, through the pulling down of strongholds, casting down of imaginations, and every high thing that exalted itself against the knowledge of God. For though we walk in the flesh, we do not war after the flesh. And so if we don't war after the flesh, how are we going to war the right way? How are we going to fight the right way? We must, the Bible says, walk in the Spirit. And when we walk in the Spirit, we will not fulfill the lust of the flesh. And so what God is doing is he's calling you. The book of Joshua is a book. It's a book. The theme is on possession, but it is a book of war. Why are we dealing with this book of war? Because we are in a war. Because the children of God are fighting. The Bible says to endure hardness as a good soldier of Christ. And that's exactly what we must do. I heard there was a little click. Just a little portion of a news. My wife was watching, and I saw just a piece of it where they were interviewing a Navy SEAL dealing with Al Qaeda that had busted up in a door, or retired Navy SEAL that is. And as soon as he busted up in there, he got shot 27 times and survived to tell the story. Got grenade shrapnel. What are you saying? That a soldier is going to have some mark. But though a just man falls 7 times, the Bible says that he will rise back up again. So what are we doing? We're preparing. We're preparing for war. Let's talk about some military tactics. The Bible says Joshua is commanded to take all the people of war with him. That happens in verse number 1. Now you look at Joshua chapter 7. This is different than the first attempt. Okay? Joshua 7 and 3 says this. And they returned to Joshua and said unto him, let not all the people go up, but let about 2,000 or 3,000 men go up and smite Ai, and make not all the people to labor thither, for they are but few. So there went up thither of the people about 3,000 men, and they fled before the men of Ai. Okay? So it was a different situation. There's a lot that one could potentially get into. Some Bible scholars say that that the reason that they sent up so few men was just because of that they had gotten arrogant. I think that's a bit of a stretch. I don't know if you could biblically prove that. But nonetheless, it's one of the things that's said. But at the end of the day, we listen to the command now of God. And he says, send all the people up. Let all the people go with you. Now, there's a chain of command that is followed. And let me talk a little bit about this chain of command, because I was saying on Sunday as I was in Nashville, I had a moment of time to speak with the young ministers there, and as well as to the congregation there. But one of the things that we're dealing with now is authority. Many of you may see it in your children. You may see it in church, and those that you deal with, we're dealing with a lack, or rather with those that buck against authority. Now, I know that things need to line up with the Word of God, and I don't believe that we necessarily need to follow people blindly. Listen, follow me as I follow Christ. But somebody, there was someone that had to expound or explain the Word of God more perfectly. There is a place for an apostle, prophet, pastor, teacher in our lives. So there was a chain of command. What do you mean? God commands Joshua, then Joshua commands the people. You find this in verses 1 through 3. We're going to understand that there is order in the house of God. We understand that when we read the Bible, that there's order in there's order in God. There's order in walking with God. There's rank and there's structure. Even with Satan, in the kingdom of darkness, if you please, there's rank and there's structure. And even in Satan's kingdom, he said, a house divided against itself, it cannot stand. So therefore, you don't see devils casting out devils. Amen. Otherwise, that kingdom could not stand. So there is a chain of command. And when we're going into warfare, and let me just challenge each and every one of us today, that for us to rise up and go to war. And if we're going to rise up and go to war, we have to have the tools through the Word of God and through prayer. Come on, somebody, and understand that I'm not going to lay down. Yes, I understand that certain things are going to happen in the end time, but I also understand, yes, I understand that in the latter days, that the Spirit speaketh expressly, that there's going to be a great falling away. There's going to be some that shall depart. It doesn't even say that some shall depart from the faith. I understand that, but I also understand that according to Joel chapter 2 and according to Acts chapter 2, that this is what the prophet was saying, that in the last days, that the Spirit of God is going to become upon, that's going to come upon your sons and your daughters. They shall prophesy, they shall dream dreams, and they shall have visions. Amen. And we shall see signs in the heaven and on the earth beneath. What are you saying? There is a revival. There is a people of God that is going to fight. And when we learn in Joshua chapter number 8, how to war and how to fight, there's a chain of command that must be followed in order for us to get victory the way that we need to get victory. The Bible goes on to say, or rather, it is significant. Okay, so now let's talk about this. So Joshua arose and all the people, verse number 3, and all the people of war to go up against Ai, and Joshua chose out 30,000 mighty men of valor. Now watch this. And sent them away by night. He commanded them, saying, behold, ye shall lie in wait against the city, even behind the city. Go not very far from the city, but be ye all ready. I'm sending you away at night, but at night I'm not sending you away to sleep. They that sleep, sleep in the night. But listen, I'm sending you away to be ready. At night, I want you to be ready. It's significant that they were sent away at night. This is end time typology. Let's talk about it. Matthew 24 and 38 says this. For as in the days that were before the flood, they were eating and drinking, marrying and giving in marriage until the day that Noah entered into the ark and knew not until the flood came and took them all away, so shall also the coming of the Son of Man be. Matthew 24 and 50. The Lord of that servant shall come in a day when he looketh not for him, and in an hour that he is not aware of. Matthew 25 and 5. While the bridegroom tarried, they all slumbered and slept, and at midnight there was a cry made, behold, the bridegroom cometh, go ye out to meet him. The Bible says of the saints of God that it is high time for the saints of God to awake out of their sleep. Joshua verses 3 and 4 of chapter number 8, he sends them away at night. When he sends them away at night, they are not to be asleep, but they are to be ready. Because we know that Christ is coming back as a thief in the night. What are you saying? The time to ambush and wreak havoc on the enemy and take back our children and take back our cities and take back, amen, our healing and get the things from God that we need from him. To take back our homes and take back our marriages and take back those things that the enemy has come in and he may have stolen away from us maybe when we were asleep. Now it is time for us to go out and fight and go to war at night. What does that mean? That means, see listen, I'm getting ready to prophesy to somebody. There's been somebody that the Lord, you've been waking up, you've been wondering why you haven't been sleeping, been waking up at 2 o'clock in the morning or whatever the case may be, when, oh man, I just can't sleep. Maybe I need to get a Unisom or maybe I need to get a this pill or that pill. You do need to get a pill, amen, before you go back to sleep. Yeah, I absolutely agree with you. You need to grab a pill, but it's not in your medicine cabinet. I hope that the pill you need to grab is on your nightstand. And that pill is the gospel. What are you saying? We need, I'm talking to me, I'm talking to everybody. Lord, if you're waking me up, if I can't go to sleep at night, let me wake up and begin to get the word out and begin to pray the word of God. Amen. And begin to go to Psalm. I don't know what to say. Let me go to Psalm and begin to go in warfare. If the enemy's going to attack at night, amen, then I need to be going to war at night, whatever time of day it is. It doesn't matter. I must always be on the ready. Amen. Glory be to the name of Jesus. Now, they all slept and slumbered, amen, when the bridegroom tarried. And then there was a cry that was made, behold, the bridegroom cometh, go ye out to meet him. 1 Thessalonians 5 and 2. Amen. Glory to God. Bless you, Brother Ayo. Amen. 1 Thessalonians 5 and 2 says, for yourselves know perfectly that the day of the Lord so cometh as a thief in the night. What are we saying? We're saying there's no surprise. I know I may sound like a broken record, but there's no surprise. These things that are happening, oh, I feel the spirit in this place. These things that are happening to us, I'm not afraid because I've got the word of God. That's why I'm not afraid. As a matter of fact, I'm bold as a lion. The Bible tells us that the saints of God ought to be bold as a lion. And that's exactly what I'm going to be, because I cannot fail with the word of God, because the Bible said that he watches over his word to perform it. How do I know I'm going to be successful? If I'm in the word, I've got to be successful, because he's going to watch over his word and make certain that his word is fulfilled. Thank you, Holy Ghost. Amen. So as we move on, now, the Bible goes on to say, 2 Peter, here's a promise, 3 and 9 and 10. The Lord is not slack concerning his promise, Hold on. As some men count slackness, we have people, the Bible says in the last days there's going to be truth breakers. Those that break covenants, those that break their promises. I thank God that he cannot lie. It is two immutable things I said in the which that he cannot lie. That's his counsel and what his promise. Or another word for promise, as the Bible says, is his oath. God, if God said it, the Bible says in Numbers 23:19 that God is not a man that he should lie, neither is he the son of man that he should repent. If he said it, he's going to do it. If he spoken it, he's going to make it come to pass. Amen. Bless the Lord. Praise God. Bless you, Sister Willie Mae, Sister Anita. Amen. Glory to God. So now he's not slack concerning his promise, but he's long suffering to usward, not willing that any should perish. I thank God that he's long suffering, because we have people, even some, maybe even including ourselves, that need to get their acts together. And yes, behold, look, come quickly. I understand all that. But I thank God that you are having mercy. I thank God that you are being long suffering to give us the time to get our acts together, to give our families and to give us time to witness to our family so that they may get their acts together as well. Goes on to say, but the day of the Lord will come. But that all should come to repentance. He wants all of us to come to repentance. What do you mean? He wants everybody to change their ways. He wants everybody to give their lives to Christ. Unfortunately, that's not going to happen. But the Bible says, probably the most popular Bible verse in the Bible, that God, John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. That he sent not his next verse, that he sent not his son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. I thank God for Christ. I thank God for that door and for him opening up that door. Now, it seems that the plan here, dealing with military tactics here, it seems that the plan here, Hold on, let me read the rest of it here. But the day of the Lord will come as a thief in the night, in which the heavens shall pass away with a great noise, and the elements shall melt with fervent heat. The earth also and the works that are therein shall be burned up. Now, as we're still dealing here in Joshua with verses 6 through 9, that says, for they will come out after us till we have drawn them from the city. For they will say they flee before us as at the first, therefore we will flee before them. It seems that the plan here was to draw the men away from the city and cut them off from it, therefore making it easier to take the city. And it shall be when you have taken, then ye shall rise up from the ambush and seize upon the city. For the Lord your God will deliver it into your hand. And it shall be when ye have taken the city that ye shall set the city on fire. We'll talk about that some today and some next week. According to the commandment of the Lord shall ye do. See, I have commanded you. Joshua therefore sent them forth, and they went to lie in ambush and abode between Bethel and Ai on the west side of Ai. But Joshua lodged that night among the people. Seems the plan was to draw the men away from the city and cut them off from before it. Therefore, like I said earlier, making it easy to take the city. A couple of things that we can deal with and learn here. First of all, what I like here is that it says that in verse 9, they went to lie in ambush. This walk with God is going to take some patience. This walk with God is going to take some endurance, some perseverance. Sometimes we're going to have to lie in ambush. What does the Bible say? Be still and know that I am God. That's what the Bible says. So the wisdom of God is listening, when we listen to the voice of God and follow his direction, even in battle. In matter of fact, not even in battle, but especially in battle. Now notice the wisdom that God uses in his divine guidance in regards to his military strategy. Now, this is a reminder for all of us to be wise in all of our battles. Let's talk about that wisdom. Ecclesiastes 7 and 19 says this: wisdom strengtheneth the wise more than 10 mighty men which are in the city. I want to just think about this for a moment. Wisdom. Come on, Proverbs readers. Ecclesiastes readers. There's wisdom in Proverbs. Wisdom that'll help us. Help us from getting foot and mouth disease. Wisdom strengtheneth the wise more than 10 mighty men which are in the city. Give me a wise man any day over just a physically strong man. Because that wise man is going to be able to defeat just that physically strong man. Okay? Especially when he has the wisdom of God. The Bible goes on to say in Ecclesiastes 9 and 18, wisdom is better than weapons of war, but one sinner destroys much good. I understand that one sinner can destroy much good, but watch what it says. Wisdom is better than weapons of war. I'm speaking to somebody. Hallelujah. I'm speaking to somebody today that God is trying to tell us, grow up in our wisdom, in our wisdom in God. See, the Bible talks about knowledge. There's a difference between knowledge and wisdom. Wisdom is the application of knowledge. You have people that are probably can blow me out of the water when it comes to Bible knowledge. But what about revelation? What about the wisdom of God? What about using this word the way God desires for it to be used and breaking it down into the wisdom of God? That's stronger than 10 mighty men. That wisdom is better than weapons of war. Blessed be your name, Jesus. Matthew 10 and 16 said this: behold, I send you forth as sheep in the midst of wolves. Now, that's crazy. I mean, you know, I thought you loved me, Lord. You're sending me forth as sheep in the midst of wolves. Now, watch how powerful wisdom is. Because this is essentially what Christ is saying, what he's implying. I send you forth as sheep in the midst of wolves. No planet that you live on, except Jesus' planet. But watch what I, in the spirit, watch what I'm saying. That you live on is a sheep going to win in a battle against a wolf. It's not going to happen. So why would you send me into the midst of wolves? Okay? Because the reason why, that's why I'm telling you, be ye therefore wise as serpents and harmless as doves. What are you saying? The wisdom of God is so powerful that he can send lambs, sheep in the midst of wolves that don't have the claws, that don't have the teeth, that don't have the growl or the howl. They got a bad. There's nothing scary about a bad. Amen. If I'm walking in the jungle, amen, glory to God, and I hear a bad, I'm not going to take off running. But if I'm walking in the midst of the forest or a jungle, somebody hear roar, I'm gone. Come on, somebody. What are you saying? The wisdom of God is so powerful that he's saying that we essentially, when we have that wisdom, we're going to survive in the midst of wolves. We're going to survive. Amen. What do you mean? Well, Stephen didn't survive. He survived. Because if you have me, you'll never see death. Come on, somebody. So if he's looking unto Christ, he's seeing Christ when people are wailing on him and gnashing on him with his teeth, because he sees something different. What does he see? Hebrews chapter 12, looking unto Jesus. He sees the author and the finisher of his faith. That's why he can run the race that has been set before him. Now, they were commanded to burn the city with fire. Verse number 8. And it shall be when you have taken the city that ye shall set the city on fire. Set the city on fire. According to the commandment of the Lord shall ye do. See, I have commanded you. Where am I going to set the city on fire? Let's keep going. Same in Joshua chapter 6, verse 24. And they burnt the city with fire, and all that was therein, only the silver and the gold and the vessels of brass and of iron, they put into the treasury of the house of the Lord. They burnt all these things with fire. Let's talk about that. God is a consuming fire. Deuteronomy 4 and 24. For the Lord thy God is a consuming fire, even a jealous God. We'll get more into fire later on, but I just wanted to bring that up then. Deuteronomy 9 and 3 says this, understand therein, therefore this day, that the Lord thy God is he which goeth over before thee as a consuming fire. So they're burning things with fire. They're burning the city with fire. But the Lord goes before you as a consuming fire. What are you saying? Anything that's not you, that's not what you want it to be, that's not what you will for it to be, amen, glory to God, burn it up with your consuming fire. What else do I want you to burn up? What other city do I want you to burn up? The Bible says that we are, there's a building, that there's a house that's been made that has not been made with hands. The Bible tells us in 1 Corinthians 6:19, as well as 1 Corinthians 3:16, that we are that temple. We are the building of God, that house that has been made not with hands. Amen. Glory to God. So what else do I want to burn up with fire? The Bible says that understand therefore this day that the Lord thy God is he which, hold on, that's not what I wanted. Amen. Yet that the Lord thy God is he which goeth over before thee as a consuming fire. He shall destroy them, and he shall bring them down before thy face. So shalt thou drive them out and destroy them quickly, as the Lord hath said unto thee. Amen. The Lord thy God is a consuming fire. What are you saying? The Bible also tells us that there's one that's coming after me, who is mightier than me. Amen. I baptize you, amen, with water. He's going to baptize you with the Holy Ghost and with fire. The Spirit of God comes in us, and that's what gets out. That's what burns out the lust. That's what burns out the pornography. That's what burns out the whole habits and the addictions and all of those things. It's the Spirit of God that lives on the inside. And so if he told them to burn everything, and in Joshua 6 and 24, when he told them, listen, I want you to burn everything, burn the whole city with fire. Only what I'm telling you to leave, let it stay. God, come in my life and burn up everything that is not you. What's that mean? That's repentance. It can't be burned up without repentance. Hebrews 12 and 29 says that for our God is a consuming fire. Amen. The Bible says in Revelation 17 and 16, and the 10 horns which thou sawest upon the beast, there these shall hate the whore, and shall make her desolate and naked, and shall eat her flesh and burn her with fire. Revelation 18 and 8. Praise the Lord, Sister Kimball. Therefore shall her plagues come in one day, death and mourning and famine, and she shall be utterly burned with fire. For strong is the Lord God who judges her. There's something to this fire. The word, okay, so, amen, glory to God. So we understand that. That's a part of the military tactic here. That's the whole point of this part I'm reading here, is that he burned the city with fire. Remember now that their commandment and what they were supposed to do all throughout the book of Joshua, not just in Jericho, not just in Ai, was utterly destroy the inhabitants of the city because they were so wicked. When you look at, I think it's Genesis rather, chapter 15, it talks about how at that time he did not decide to destroy Canaan land in the time of Abraham because the iniquity or the sin of the Amorites was not yet full. When you begin to read throughout how wicked these people were, how they were just full of pagans, they were the sacrificing that they did, And so one of the scriptures I quote quite often in 1 Corinthians 15 and 33, that evil communications corrupts good manners, is that he wanted them to utterly drive them out. And we'll continue to hear this theme here throughout the book of Joshua. He wanted them to drive out these inhabitants. The reason why is because if you don't drive them out, it's going to be a Solomon situation. What do you mean? Your wife, Solomon, the thing that you love, these concubines and these thousand women, they're going to drive you to worship other gods, and you're the wisest man on the face of the earth that lived at that time, that's ever lived, and that ever will live, save Jesus Christ. Amen. Glory to God. So now verse number 10 says, of Joshua chapter 8 says, and Joshua rose up early in the morning and numbered the people and went up, he and the elders of Israel, before the people to Ai. I'm going to come back to that. I missed something that I wanted to point out. In Joshua, verse number 9, chapter 8, it talks about how they lie in ambush. And it also goes on and talks about how Joshua lodged that night among the people. That says something about leadership. And Joshua, it seems to me, was a leader's leader, a man's man, a man of valiant, a man of valor, just a valiant and a mighty man, but yet a humble man. And as the leader, he knew when to be out in front of the people. He knew when to send the people. And he knew when to lodge with the people. There's some comfort. I was a military man. There's some comfort to the general coming and just being a part with the troops. There's some comfort to the sergeant major coming in and being among the specialists and the privates. There's some comfort to that. So I just didn't want to pass that by without making that point. And for all of the leaders in the house, whether it's pastors, leaders in your home, whatever the case may be, there are times when he wants us to lie among the people. Amen. And why? Because it gives them comfort in the battle. It gives them confidence in the battle to know daddy's here with you, mama's here with you, meemaw, pawpaw, whatever it is here with you. Amen. Glory to God. So verse 10 says, and Joshua rose up early in the morning and numbered the people and went up, he and the elders of Israel, glory to God, and he and the elders of Israel before the people to Ai. Now let's talk here about this number the people. This word number comes from a Hebrew word. It's the Hebrew word pakad, pakad. The transliteration of that pakad is spelled P-A-Q-U-A-D. I'll send those study guides out to you. But it doesn't mean number that he sat there and counted the people. That's not what it means. This Hebrew word here means to charge, to oversee, to muster. Muster means to assemble troops, especially, and we'll probably end with this. Didn't get as far as I wanted to, but let me go back to where I was, because we're going to pick up next week with victory. But the word number here in verse 10, like I said, means to charge, oversee, muster. Muster means to assemble troops, especially for an inspection or in preparation for battle. What are you saying? It's time for the troops to be assembled. And it's time for us to be inspected. Who goes, you ain't got the right to tell me, inspect me, move the beam out your own eye so you get the speck out of my eye. Well, what do you mean by inspection? Well, the Bible says this. Come on, Brother Michael Jackson. Look in the mirror. It says, examine yourself. James. I want to talk about inspection. Let me go to James real quick. Because I could quote it, but I want to get it right. Glory to God. So James, I'm old fashioned. I'm in my print Bible. Amen. Glory to God. They still make these. They still make print Bibles, in case you're wondering. They're still available. Amen. I know these are ancient to some people. We use our tablets and our phones, but I love a print Bible, even though it's taken me forever to get to James. Amen. Glory to God. But James chapter number 1. Hallelujah. It says this. We're there. He says, in verse 22. But be ye doers of the word and not hearers only. I'm talking about examining now, inspecting, deceiving your own selves. For if any be a hearer of the word, I'm sorry. Yeah. But for if any be a hearer of the word and not a doer, he is like unto a man beholding his natural face in a glass. That's talking about a mirror. For he beholdeth himself and goeth his way and straightway forgetteth what manner of man he was. What do you mean, assemble? If we're getting ready to go in battle, we have to be inspected. What inspects us? Ultimately, the Word of God inspects us. Now, the ministry, you can call it fivefold ministry, comes as a part of that inspection. For the perfecting of the saints, for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ. It all works together. The apostle, prophet, pastor, the teacher, the evangelist, right? That's all a part of that. The Bible says, examine yourself, whether you be in the faith. How do we examine ourselves? Not according to our own self, because the Bible clearly says that, listen, a man thinketh himself to be right. I'm paraphrasing. Until his neighbor comes and examines him or searches him. Same thing. That's why the Bible says that there is in the multitude of counselors, there is safety. Another place talks about there's wisdom in the multitude of counselors. The Word of God must, as we get ready and assemble and prepare for battle, we must be inspected by the Word of God. And see, when we are inspected by the Word of God, we don't get as offended. We don't get, you know, upset. Been times when I've been ministering, speaking the word and quoted a scripture. That's why if I'm not going to quote it exact, I say I'm paraphrasing and quoted a scripture. I've had an elder, not meanly, but if I left out a word or two, correct me in that. I can't get offended by that. It's the word. The word is what, if I allow the word to examine me, then when someone comes and expounds the word of God more perfectly to me, or uses the word of God to examine my life, or to point something out in my life, I must be careful with getting offended with that. And so Joshua, as the leader, he assembled the troops together. He lined them up for inspection. It's a poor leader. It's a poor leader that does not inspect the troops. People are going to get upset. It's never my goal to upset anyone. I think any real leader, any real pastor, prophet, apostle, any real leader that's leading the people of God, it's not the goal for them to get upset. But when you look at the book of Ezekiel, time and time again, it talks about the responsibility to sound an alarm. And that if we don't sound that alarm, then that blood is on our hands and God's holding us accountable. So how are we going to inspect? And we're ending with inspecting, because that's what this numbering, he numbered the people. He assembled them together for inspection. Why do children of God, I'm getting ready to close. Why do children of God head into battle and lose? Well, we found out the first reason in chapter number 7, because they head into battle and there's an accursed thing in the camp. Right? The next reason, after that sin has been purged and removed, is because they're not inspected before moving into battle. We must be inspected by the true word of God. We must be inspected by the real word of God. Come on, somebody. And so that's why, but how can we be inspected by something that we don't know? We must know the word of God. We must read the scriptures. I'm falling more and more and more in love with the word of God. I've not gone further away from God during COVID-19. I have gone closer to God because I believe in this situation, I'm in need of God. And he's showing me how much I need him and how much I must not only inspect myself, but that the people of God must be inspected, not in a way that judges. What do you mean? By the word of God. I'm the leader is inspecting the people right now. You ain't got the right to inspect me. It's not me. It's the word of God that's doing it. That's why, and they used to make fun of me in Nashville. I'd read all these scriptures and stuff. But you know what? There's power to having scripture. Because if I'm quoting to you scripture or reading to you from the Bible, guess what I'm not doing? Talking out of my own self. If I'm making reference to the Bible, I'm not giving you my own opinion. I got so much more I could say, but listen. This week, what's your homework? Number. What do you mean? Assemble yourself for battle. Get ready. Come before your leader. Who's your leader? God. And let him inspect you today. Open up that, get that mirror in the morning. You do it every morning? I hope so. You get those boogers out your nose. Praise God. Get that sleep out your eyes. Slobber from all around your mouth. You examine it. Listen, if you get ready to go, if we get ready to go on a date, amen, glory to God, whatever the case may be, you get ready to go out, you better believe you're looking in that mirror. Well, guess what? We all getting ready to go on a date. We're getting ready to meet the bridegroom. Amen. We're going on a date. So I got to get ready for that date. What is that date when Christ comes back? I want him to find a church without spot or wrinkle. He's going to find a church without spot or wrinkle. There's no question about that. The question is, are we going to be a part of that church that's without spot or wrinkle? Are we going to make certain that our lives line up with the word of God and that we are ready for inspection? God bless you. Amen, Sister Nita. God bless you. We love you. So glad to see everyone that has joined us and that has been with us. We'll let you know more about it. We're getting ready to, we thank God we'll be coming together soon. Letting you know some more about that on Sunday. Restrictions have been lifted. We've had a few trying to come in to the services. And again, the restrictions have been lifted, though we've not officially opened our doors. We're going to let you know more about that on Sunday. Amen. As far as for re-entry, we are asking those that we're recommending masks, all of those that will be working with anyone and be on the front lines will be being properly screened and will have on the proper protective gear as well in any of those situations we want you to feel comfortable. We want you to feel comfortable. We'll be letting you know about our official open up dates. Amen. Glory to God. And we're just looking forward to being with you all once again on our Sunday mornings. But we'll let you know more about that on this coming Sunday. Amen. Glory to God. Well, anyhow, we're going to pray. We thank God for helping us today. Thank God for the word. Love each and every one of you. I want to let you know, and I want to say to you, be encouraged. Be encouraged. It's time for the people of God. It's time for each and every one of us to go to another level in God, to go to another place in Him. I'm not discouraged. I'm very much encouraged because I believe that I'm going to another place in God. God bless you. Let us pray. Father, we love you. We thank you for all that you are doing in our lives, how wonderful and magnificent you are. Lord, it is my prayer here today that I have helped someone. Rather, it wouldn't be me, but it would be you, Father, that this word has helped, and that we allow this word to continue to inspect us, God, and be everything that you desire for it to be in our lives. We give you glory in this house. We thank you for your power. We thank you for your might, O God. You are a wonderful King. So magnificent, God. And Lord, we just ask you to continue to go with us and be with us as we give you glory, as we give you honor and praise. Thank you for everybody on this live stream. In Jesus' name. Now, the people say, let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight. O Lord, my strength and my redeemer, God bless you. Love you, praying for you in Jesus' name.